part of the aura is the so-called protective net, which rejects hostile influences like a shield. It is formed, maintained, and strengthened by our psychic energy. The protective net can defend a man, making him invulnerable. The protective net must be continually saturated with energies from within. The susceptibility to negative suggestions, influences, or interferences is usually the result of an insufficiently developed protective net. Each striving consciousness must weave its own protective net. One may deflect many blows and painful stings if the protective net remains impenetrable. The immunity of the spiritual centers may become complete when the protective net is continually nourished by fire from within. Hence, it is so important to be solicitous about the tension of the protective net. Psychic energy, aspiration of the spirit, and fiery transmutation will supply the needed fabric for the protective net. On the path to the fiery world, let us remember the power of this shield. With the help of our psychic energy, we can weave a protective net around us, which works like an armor and is impenetrable for physical and psychical attacks. Man can draw upon any force within himself and forge from it an invincible armor. Psychic energy was sometimes called Teros. In the Hermetic teaching, one can find this expression: the warrior Teros raised his shield. So was indicated the protective role of psychic energy. Did you ever hear of a yogi spearing devoured by beasts? There was never such an occurrence, for no animal that possesses a particle of instinct would dare pit itself against the shield of Teros. Many are in need of protection. Why then not utilize one's own treasure? For today's spiritual warriors, this protection by spiritual means, by a spiritual armor, is much more important and effective than any physical defense. For us, steel coats of mail are not needed, for the armor of psychic energy is far stronger. Thus, one can surround oneself with an impenetrable, invisible armor. People may notice the invulnerability of some heroes. To attain this, a powerful upsurge of the will is needed in order to face dangers without harm. The thinker, Plato, taught the young people, sometimes the best armor is the invisible one. Learn to command yourself to produce such an armor, and it will appear whenever you fight for the common good. This is so because ultimately the spiritual laws govern the material plane. Psychic energy dominates the physical laws. One should observe numerous examples in all of life. We often make use of our own psychic energy and with its help avert the most powerful hostile arrows. It should be remembered that the link with hierarchy is stronger than armor. hostile energies, physical or spiritual ones, directed against us, are rejected. They hit the shield and knock back at the attacker. If he suffers damage, then not because of a hit of the defender, but through his own aggressive energy that has turned back against himself. Each blow upon the aura may be reflected as a boomerang upon its sender. It is not difficult to accumulate the energy of Terrors or to evoke it, and it is not advisable to lose consciousness at the decisive moment, for that would produce a condition not unlike that of the so-called deadly eye. A yogi does not kill an animal by his own will. It is the evil will that smashes itself against the shield of Terrors. One has to understand that not a coercive will, but the accumulation of the chalice will provide protection and permit action. Each one who has developed psychic energy is protected by it. People are afraid to assault one who possesses special powers. Common wisdom remembers how the reverse blow works that strikes the armor of Terrors. We had already spoken about the aura of objects, for example, antiques. This is due to accumulations of psychic energy caused by the men who have fabricated or used these things. Likewise, common wisdom knows that some people can leave their influence on objects. This is true. Psychic energy can, for example, be transmitted to objects through touch. Thus, one may observe the power of thought and the emanations of psychic energy. One can impregnate an object consciously with a certain energy, with a command of the will, with a thought or a message. The energy can be accumulated in objects, which can then be used for concentration of the will. A considerable accumulation of energy can even make objects radiate or transmit a suggested thought. This is the scientific explanation of the nature of sacred objects. One can find in them accumulations of psychic energy. Such objects, for example, altars, paintings, or icons, work like a magnet which radiates force into the environment and noticeably strengthens the people who approach it. If even radio waves have such a powerful influence on man, how powerfully can objects saturated with psychic energy act? The magnet that is consciously saturated transmits its magnetic currents. Thus, our emanations surround each transmitted gift. Therefore, the affirmed action of our sendings can always intensify the strength of the one to whom they are sent. Talismans and teraphs were consciously charged with energy, which remains in effect for thousands of years and gives the wearer protection and power.
In
In various countries there were scattered a multitude of teraphs, each one filled with the accumulations of many psychic transmissions. It is curious to observe the continued vitality of these accumulations of psychic energy. One can truly see their teraphs retain their power over thousands of years. You can consciously and scientifically use these opportunities. For example, charge a gift with your personal magnetism, or put your hand on the shoulder of an interlocutor in order to increase your persuasiveness. In ancient times, it was customary when giving a gift to place one's hand upon the gift, and even to hold it close for a while. Thus, the magnetism of the donor was transferred to the object. Sometimes the gift was wrapped in hair or dipped into magnetized water. If even in ancient times people had an idea of the primary energy, surely by today we should be able to apply it scientifically. Psychic energy, the divine fire within us, promotes our spirituality. Agni declines to such an extent that the animal principles take possession of the fallen ones. Again, it is instructive to note how the decrease of Agni permits the manifestation of animal propensities. Agni, the savior, leads to beautiful worlds, but one must cultivate it and not forget its existence. With the help of the energy of the heart, you can put yourself in a sublime state of mind, a state of purity, power, and joy, and thus live in a higher world, regardless of the material circumstances. Man realizes that psychic energy protects him from illnesses and from doubts and depression. But even more than providing such protection against mighty enemies, psychic energy can transform one's entire existence. Likewise, psychic energy leads one into the supermundane world. This is especially true after death. It is your store of fiery energy which carries you to heaven. It is a natural desire to want to know how the transitions into different spheres are accomplished. It is not difficult to understand that purified Agni is the decisive factor. If we gradually fill a balloon with combustible gas, it will begin to rise proportionately. If the balloon cannot retain the gas, it will descend. This is a crude example of the principle governing transition into the various spheres of the subtle world. The subtle being can ascend by itself if its fiery seed is appropriately filled. Fire, the transmuter, helps to assimilate the new and higher conditions. For conclusion, let us repeat once again. The development of psychic energy is the most vital task of humanity. Every applied thought will bring growth to the spirit. A whole program for the expansion of your spiritual strength is made available by our Institute of Psychic Energy. Please visit us at psychische-energie-institut.de.